Well, what's going on, Gideon's Tactical family? Thanks so much for joining me here on another video. I'm Aaron, and I'm hanging out here at one of my local open spaces, and I figured it would be the perfect time to talk about a very important topic: medical kits and medical preparedness, and what's my and your level of medical preparedness. And what I hope to do in this video is just go through my system and kind of my three-layered system, from individual to multi-person to the whole family, and just give you some tips and tricks, but also give you some ideas and some peace of mind that you don't have to be intimidated by a medical emergency, even though it may be very high stress. So folks, I invite you to come along with me and dive in as we take a look at medical preparedness and some of the equipment and knowledge that will help give you a leg up if, and God forbid, when a medical emergency may strike. All right, let's jump into it with our stage one of three medical kits we're gonna look at today, and that is your IFAC, or individual first aid kit. Now, this is a kit that's compact, lightweight, small, and easily deployable, that you can basically take with you everywhere you go, every time you head out the door. And I believe that regardless if you are a soccer mom just going from point A to point B and dropping the kids off at sports in school, or you work in an office environment, you work on a construction site, or you're an outdoor enthusiast like myself who loves mountain biking and hiking and camping and all the outdoor activities that you may do, having something like this basically with arm's reach all the time, I believe, is vital more than ever in the world that we now live in. And so this pouch right here is an 1110 design, made right here in America. It's compact, it has a lot of different lashing points and attachments. It's easily identifiable in case it was in a bag somewhere and I was telling someone, because I was the one that was injured, hey, go get that. It's over there, it's got the medical logo on it. It's very easy to identify, and it's also easy to deploy. It's not just like a Ziploc bag with everything just flopping around inside of it. It's something that one-handed, in case one of my hands was injured, whatever, I could grab it, do whatever I had to, and pull out the contents of this pouch. And for me, I've basically designed it as twofold. First being a trauma kit, being able to take care of certain trauma situations up to and including either lacerations, stab wounds, or gunshot wounds, as well as secondarily some boo-boo kit aspects to it. You scrape your knee, you got, you know, you fell off your bike and you kind of got a little, you know, scab or scratch, and you know, there, it's not good, you need to clean it, but it's not something that's life-threatening in any way. It does have the ability to do that as well. But I've kind of built it all around and started out with this one item, and this is one item I want to talk about with you that you will see in every single kit that I have, and that is a SWAT T tourniquet. Now, this bad boy is going to cost you less than $15, and it's smaller than your cell phone, but it has a dual capability and has, in fact, saved a friend's life of mine. It's basically a giant medical grade rubber band. I mean, that's basically how I can describe it to you. It's a giant long rubber band that can be used either as a compress for a less intense or traumatizing wound, or as a full-on tourniquet to cut off blood circulation in the case of a heavy bleeding wound like a stab or a gunshot wound. So you can do it either way, just depending on how you want to deploy it. The simple instructions on the back. If you're not familiar with these, I would encourage you to maybe buy two, practice with one so you get familiar with how it is used, and then have one ready to deploy in an emergency situation. And I'm about to tell you how I use this in just a moment, but first I want to give a big shout out to today's sponsor of this video, which is LA Police Gear. And I'm really excited and glad that they're sponsoring this video, not only because they're an amazing place to purchase your gear and equipment through, and they've been online as a major distributor for name brand products for years and years at this point, but they're an amazing place to source out your medical supplies, because oftentimes when you pick up through other different websites, it's very difficult to know where the true sources of are these knockoff tourniquets and coagulants and different things like that, or are these like truly from those manufacturers. And when it's a life and death situation and a piece of equipment that could save a life, you want it to be sourced properly, and that's what you know you're getting with LA Police Gear. So I have started purchasing all of my medical equipment through LA Police Gear, but also many of my other gear items. With so many amazing name brands to choose from, it's really a great one-stop shop to not only pick up medical equipment, but so many other items, from boots and blades to packs and apparel, firearm accessories, and everything in between, as well as LA Police Gear's own name brand of gear and apparel that you can check out as well. So I invite you to check out that hyperlink that I have for you guys below. And I also have a promo code for you, a GT12 for you. That's going to give you 12% off your purchase. Not only are you helping to support a brand that and a site that is giving good sourced gear and equipment for us, you're helping me and you're helping yourself with that promo code. And that just lets them know that we sent you, and it helps me continue to make content just like this for you guys. And so with that, let's go ahead and get back to it and continue to discuss the knowledge, but also equipment for your medical needs and scenarios. So I want to share with you the experience that I've had with the SWAT-T tourniquet. Was several years ago, I was camping with a buddy of mine, and it was just a freak accident. We were splitting wood, and knife went into his leg, just toppled over through a piece of wood and pierced him and started to pulsate blood out of him. So we knew it was a bad situation. Right away, we were in serious trouble. And thank goodness I knew how to use and had one of these, as well as many other medical supplies we're about to look at today, with me in my kit. I used it in an attempt to use it as a compress, but because of the stress and the momentary situation, I basically cut off all circulation to the laceration on his thigh, and threw him in the truck, doused the fires, threw the dogs, left everything else, left our camp basically set up, and started heading back at the hour or so into town with no cell phone coverage. And as we finally got into town, the ambulance waiting for us took him the rest of the way. And when they got to the hospital, the doctors said if he did not have this SWAT-T tourniquet deployed onto his thigh and onto that injury, he probably would have bled out. And so I swear by these. I've had experience with them. The bonus, on top of some more complicated strap and lock mechanism tourniquets we're going to look at here in just a little bit, that may in some ways be easier to deploy on yourself or situations like that. These can be deployed on children as well as on your pets. If there's an injury on your kids or pets, that sometimes certain other tourniquets you can't really do because of their size or buckles get in the way on smaller diameter appendages. So there's always positives in the sense of my buddy, but also negatives and drawbacks to deploying tourniquets and things like that, and compresses. So you got to know your stuff. So you may be asking yourself, well, how did you know what to do? I took it upon myself to educate myself. I got books like this one right here that we actually keep in our stage 3 full size, extra large medical kit we'll look at here in a little bit. This has all kinds of tips and tricks and different diagrams on how to take care of all sorts of medical situations, from the very minimal to the extreme. And this helped a lot, doing research on my own, getting the training that needed to be done. There's all kinds of free classes available that you can research and look into. Oftentimes your local fire department and trauma teams will do free training or very inexpensive training. And I think it's well worth it to have a rudimentary understanding of how to use not only just bandages and, you know, ointments properly, but how to handle big damaging wounds that are traumatic, to stabilize yourself or a loved one until paramedics can arrive and take over from there. And so I encourage you to do that, because I am not a medical professional. I have no training outside of just what I have learned and gone through a couple classes and done the different things that I personally know. And so by no means am I a professional in this category, but I am someone that has not only experienced it firsthand, but also just taken upon myself to learn as much as I can to feel comfortable with stabilizing those around me, to get them to the professionals who can take over and save a life and, you know, stabilize them and do what needs to be done. So I encourage you to pursue that in your journey of becoming medically prepared. So just a few other items, just go with you real quick before we go to the next one, is I have Celox as well. This is a coagulant that we'll talk about here in just a little bit that will clot the blood that's on a bandage. I got, you know, your gloves. I got some antihistamine, got a little Band-Aid set up here just for some scrapes and boo-boos and things like that. And then obviously a bandage right here that I could use in tandem with the SWAT-T if I wanna use it more as a compress. And so this stage one IFAC gives me a really good sense of security, of preparedness everywhere I go. And so with that, let's go ahead and take a look at stage two. All right, so now we're on to stage two, which is much larger and can handle more situations than the IFAC or the individual first aid kit. Now, this has two purposes. One, it's in my vehicle all the time, and it's in an area where me as the driver can easily access it. It has a little quick release right here that we're gonna look at in just a second that I can snap and pull that off. So let's go ahead and hop out and take a look at this stage two medical kit and what I have inside. Alrighty, so this is the 511 emergency ready pouch. My next level will be the ready bag. I've gone through all sorts of different medical kits over the years. This back way is a little trickier, but there you go. And that's why I like this guy. First off is just that it's a pretty compact size, but I can get a lot in it. So this has a kind of hidden pouch that makes it very easy for you to get things out like shears. And if you can have a pair of shears, that's very vital and important, so you can cut away the cloth and material so you can really see what's going on and where the wound is. And then it does have the ability to pull out your CAT tourniquet and carry a larger CAT tourniquet in. And so I just want to go into a little more detail on the CAT tourniquet and models like that. Now, this is like the next level of tourniquet. It usually has a crank option to it. And these things can absolutely save a life, particularly if there's already an amputation in the injury possibly, or, you know, it's just hanging on, or it's a very bad situation. These can be deployed. Now, as I said a little earlier, the drawback is sometimes they won't work on smaller appendages, like for smaller frame children and things like that, or your pets. If your pet had a really bad laceration or something like that, probably won't work on those situations, but they are easier to deploy on yourself and particularly one-handed if you're doing it to an arm than even the SWAT. The SWAT is not too difficult once you practice a few times, but this is even easier, and you can absolutely get tons and tons of leverage because you just keep cranking on it. Now, again, the main reason to use this is because it's a life-threatening bleed, and it looks like they may bleed out, and that's why you're doing that. To deploy this could mean the loss of a limb. So know and take into consideration how bad the wound is before you deploy something like this. Make sure to write down the time or take a snapshot on your phone. Remember it so that the medical professionals who are taking it off and working with the person can handle that and know what to do and how to do that. Know the risks and know the risks as well as the protections of like Good Samaritan laws when you're maybe doing it to someone else who's not related to you. What either type of liability you're taking upon yourself if you're doing it or lack thereof, depending on what country, state, you know, part of the world you live in. All right, so as we go along here and I unzip this guy, easy to open. You know, in an emergency situation, you often lose most of your fine motor skills, and gross motor skills are important. And I like how this fillets it all open so I can really see what's going on, what do I have access to, particularly if I had to work on myself or something like that. So what we have here kind of on the front end is all the high intensity stuff, and kind of on the back end is less intense situational stuff. We have that SWAT tourniquet again. Over here I have a triangular bandage that it works as not only a sling but just a compress. And then over here we have coagulants. This is going to be Celox anomaly powder, which you need to be conscientious of. If that was to blow around and get in your mouth or eyes, it can cause severe damage. It's a powder that will keep bleeding and coagulate the blood. So that's a very good thing to have, but you need to be aware of some of the dangers of it as well. And then this is a Celox bandage. So this is a bandage wrapped in and coated with the Celox. So it's not a powder, it's part of the bandage, and that will be better in not only high stress situations, but also possibly windy situations, and you know, you don't get the powder in your eyes or in your mouth or something like that. So just kind of be aware of that and know the positives and negatives of blood coagulants like that. I have one more that also does that. This is a quick clot, again, more for multiple scenarios or multiple wounds. And that's where this medical kit comes into is possibly multiple people have been injured or one person has been injured in multiple ways. And in multiple parts of their body, I have the ability to do that with multiple things. Then back here, we do have an enter and exit wound. This is mostly for gunshot and or being impaled in certain ways. Maybe you're on a job site and someone falls on a piece of rebar, different things like that. Whatever the situation may be, again, knowing what's best, is it better to leave them until medical attention arise, or they stable, is it better to get that out and then stabilize them? This will seal the wound on the front and back of their body. So this is, again, very high intensity gunshot wounds. You never know what you're going to encounter in this life, particularly in this day and age. So those are all very important. So that's all the high kind of high stress stuff. Back here, we have an Israeli bandage. This is one of the smaller ones. This is basically a very heavy, thick piece of cloth, then with some extra bandage that you can wrap and kind of tie tight. So it's a compress. This works very well. Then we just have some other cloth bandages here, adhesive tape. Got the little pouch. That's full of kind of all the boo-boo kit stuff. And then back here, something that people kind of maybe miss sometimes is what's it called? Eye drops. It's very important. I've had multiple scenarios, not only on myself, but with friends, where a piece of little chip of wood when we're out camping or, just working or whatever it is, flies in your eyes. You weren't, using eye protection when you should have. And oftentimes it can be easily remedied with just some eye drops and kind of flush out the eye. Whereas if you don't have that, you're trying to use a water bottle and, it can just be really nasty and just not work very well. That's a really good solution for that. Then you just got, your antibiotic cream, as well as some new skin as well, liquid bandage stuff. That stuff will burn, but it does do a really good job with a lot of different scenarios. And then I just have another big fat bandage back here, easily accessible if I needed to do that. So I'm sure there are a few things, buried in there that I've missed, but that kind of gives you a good idea on why I have that not only in my vehicle, but also as a multi-layered when I go on maybe multi-day backpacking trips, camping with a buddy, something like that. There's a lot in there that can cover a lot of different scenarios. All right, folks, so now on to stage three, the extra large medical kit. Now, I'm married, I have a wife, I have two amazing boys, so I'm a dad. We come to this park often to play and hang out and, do activities. And with two energetic under five-year-olds, injuries is a regular occurrence at our house. Thankfully, they're almost always minor, but you never know. So this is a very quick, very easily accessed, and this is the 5-11 emergency ready bag, larger than the pouch. And there's all kinds of great pouches and kits and options out there. This one just has really been working for me for the last year and a half or so. They are available, as well as all this stuff again, over at LA Police Gear. So again, check out those links and discount codes. But what's going on with this option? So we got the shoulder strap, so again, we could throw it over our shoulder and then run out into the cul-de-sac or downstairs or wherever it is, that we need to, or again, taking it maybe on a camping trip, throw it in your camper, whatever it is, as well as some grab handles. On the front here, we have a lot with, again, shears. We got the tourniquet. We have gloves. That was something that I caught with the other bag. I forgot, need to replace my glove scenario, but gloves, an emergency whistle, and again, a flashlight. I mean, you can see just how much stuff is in here. And it's a lot of it is what we saw in the stage two. It's just more of it or larger amounts of it. But we have a few things that I'll hit real quick. Now, going back to what we talked about earlier, we put this first aid fundamentals in this just to help us. We've got all kinds of different very large gauze pads and things like that. I've got all the Celox and coagulants, all sorts of different options back there, multiple layers of that. Big boo-boo kit in here. Whoosh, zip that bad boy up. But we have in here as well some cold packs that you don't need ice for. You just pop those suckers and that will help with swelling. A tick remover kit, and just very large things. Again, these big bandages. I got two of the triangular bandages versus just one, things like that. And that's one of the last things I just want to leave you with is in every scenario, a lot of it is just having the things ready and prepared. God forbid you need to use them. And in every scenario, that's what these bags, these pouches, and just the equipment in general is laid out for, is so that when the moment strikes, you're not trying to remember where the medical stuff is. You're not trying to fish and hunt around for whatever item that you need to stop bleeding, to stop cuts, to put an ice pack on, to stabilize, whatever the situation may be. And you know right where it is, and you're confident in how you deploy it. And some of that is not only taking classes possibly, being educated, educate yourself, but also just having a mindset of when an emergency strikes like this in the medical field, am I prepared? And if not, what do I need to do to get prepared? Well, there you have it, guys. I hope that you have enjoyed this video. I hope it's been fun and entertaining, but also informative, giving you some ideas, some knowledge, some data, so that you can just be better prepared if and when a medical emergency were to happen in your own life or to someone else, and you just happen to be passing by, that you have some level of understanding and this sends you in the right direction to get the knowledge, to get trained, to get supplied, so that you're ready for scenarios and situations that we never know when may happen. Every single medical emergency that has occurred in my life was obviously unpredictable. It happened in a moment's notice. And I was so glad that I had what I needed in those different scenarios throughout my life. And I hope to still be prepared throughout my entire life if and when those situations may occur. So thank you guys so much. I invite you to check out the other video popping up. Subscribe if you're not yet a subscriber. We're throwing up content like this all the time. Check us out on social media as well. And until next time, always remember, stay equipped, stay prepared, and we'll see you out there.